As we go into the Bible, into history, to try to find out the truth of the matter of the identity of the lost tribes of Israel. I do not ask anyone to believe these things that I'm going to put forth just because I say so. Rather, I ask that you go and look for yourself and draw your own conclusions and do your own research. That is the only way you can prove or disprove anything to yourself. Before we begin this study, let us go to the Father in prayer. Heavenly Father, glorious King of the universe, we come before you this day, and we ask you, Father, to open our eyes and ears to truth. We ask you to reveal things long hidden. We ask you to bring forth knowledge which has fallen by the wayside, so that we may know the truth of the matter. We ask that your hand and your wisdom be upon this study, Father. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The lost tribes of Israel, where did they go? Are they really lost? No, not really. Our Father has never lost track of them in their wanderings. It is only man who has forgotten and lost track of them down through the ages. But then that too was promised to happen by our Father in His Word. However, with a little study in our Father's Word, the Bible, and from history, anyone may reclaim the knowledge of where the lost tribes of Israel have gone, and who they are today. Now, most proceed with the false assumption that the Jewish peoples of the world, that is to say the modern Jews, are all that remains of the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel. However, that is a misconception. Simple mathematics alone would tell us that the Jews of the world do not add up to the numbers of how many there should be from the 12 tribes of Israel. And the modern Jews are made up mainly of two tribes, the tribe of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin, with a handful of Levites thrown in. Plus, there are a large number of peoples who claim to be Jews that are not, as alluded to by Christ in the book of Revelation chapter 2 and 3, and clarified by Christ in St. John chapter 8, and given as a parable by Christ in the parable of the tares. Now the story of Israel begins all the way back with Adam, the father of the Adamic peoples. Adamic, a word meaning ruddy complected, or to show blood in the face. From Adam's progeny would come a man named Noah, Noah of the time of the flood, written in Genesis. After the flood of Noah, Noah's son Shem would beget a group of people called the Shemites. This is where the word Semite or Semitic comes from. Noah was the ninth from Adam. In other words, he was the ninth generation from Adam. And his son Shem would be the 10th generation from Adam. And Shem's descendants would bring forth a man named Abram, which interpreted from the Hebrew tongue means the father of greatness or man of greatness. And Abraham found favor with God because Abram obeyed God and walked with God. And God so loved Abraham till he made many promises to him. And he changed his name to Abraham, which being interpreted from the Hebrew tongue means the father of many nations or father of many peoples. Now Abraham left his birthplace in the land of Ur, located between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers, purported to be where the Garden of Eden once existed and where modern-day Iraq exists today. And as he and his families crossed over the river Euphrates and went towards the land of Canaan, from that time forward, he was called an Eber, meaning he was called a Hebrew. The word Hebrew, or Eber, is a word that means one that crossed over the waters, or one that crossed over the river. It also has a symbology of crossing out of Babylon, which is where the land of Ur was, and where the events of the Tower of Babel took place. The word Babylon having two meanings in the Bible, one meaning the geographical location of Babylon, the other meaning confusion. And as we will see later, Abraham's progeny would cross over many waters. In the book of Genesis, chapter 22 and verse 17, God said unto Abraham, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of heaven and as the sands of the seashore, or the sands upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. 18. And in thy seed shall the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. Now there are various reasons for this blessing that would come upon all nations. First of all, through Abraham would come Isaac, Jacob, the tribes of Israel, and Judah, and of Judah would come Jesse and David, and of David's seed line would be born one called Jesus Christ, who was the Son of God, which is the majority of the reason. The other being that the people of Israel would take the word of God forth to all the world. You may want to make a mental note concerning stars. We shall reference the symbology several times in this study. So Abraham had 8 sons from the bondwoman Hagar and his wives Sarah and Keturah. And these sons would bring forth a multitude of peoples. But we will continue with the study of Abraham's son Isaac. As it is written in the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verse 12, and God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman, referring to Hagar and Ishmael. In all that Sarah hath said unto thee, hearken unto her voice. For in Isaac shall thy seed be called. In other words, it would be through Isaac that would come Jacob, the tribes of Israel, and so on, as I alluded to earlier. But it was grievous to Abraham because Sarah wanted Abraham to put away Hagar and Ishmael. And of course, Ishmael was the son of Abraham, who would father the Arabic peoples, quite frankly. But let's continue. Abraham's son Isaac came of age and took a wife named Rebekah. And she conceived. And in Genesis chapter 25, verse 22, it reads, and the children struggled together within her. And she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And went to inquire of the Lord. Verse 23. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels, and the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. So it came to pass that to Isaac were born two sons, twins, Esau and Jacob. But by tradition, the firstborn was to claim the inheritance, the blessing. So Esau was the elder and Jacob was the younger, though they were born only moments apart. But in the course of time, Esau would sell his birthright, which is to say his inheritance, his blessings, to his brother Jacob for a bowl of pottage. And Esau's progeny would become the children of Edom, the Edomites, meaning red. And eventually they would become known as the Rus, also meaning red, which would eventually migrate and become called the Rusians, or the Russians, as we know them today. In the fullness of time, Jacob did inherit the blessing of Isaac through covert action by him and his mother, and he took two wives when he went to dwell with his uncle Laban. His two wives were Rachel and Leah. And with Rachel and Leah and their two handmaids, Jacob had a total of 12 sons. These 12 sons of Jacob would become the 12 patriarchs of the 12 tribes of Israel. The name Israel, fully translated from the Hebrew tongue, means the prince that prevailed with God, or the prince that prevails with God. This was the name given to Jacob when he wrestled all night with the angel of the Lord at Penuel. But this name has a twofold meaning. It also means that without God, the prince shall not prevail. And this will be a theme repeated by Israel over and over and over again as they stray away from God and lose their blessings and are scattered. Now, most are familiar with the story of Jacob's son, Joseph, and how he was sold into the bondage of Egypt by his 11 jealous brothers. But God did not forsake Joseph. Rather, he gave him special gifts to discern dreams and foretell the future. And because of this, and the wisdom of Joseph, he rose to power in Egypt and became second only to Pharaoh. But later, due to a famine in the land, his 11 brothers were forced to enter into Egypt for grain, and over the course of events set forth by God, came to stand before Joseph. And Joseph tested them to see whether they had changed. And of course they had. And eventually Joseph reunited and reconciled with his brothers and forgave them all. And he brought them and his father to dwell in the land of Egypt for the remainder of their lives. We're going to read some of his blessings upon Ephraim and Manasseh. But first, let's go and learn of Ephraim and Manasseh. So Genesis chapter 41. Genesis 41 and 51. And Joseph called the name of his firstborn Manasseh. For God, said he, hath made me to forget all my toil and all my father's house. Verse 52. And the name of the second he called Ephraim. For God hath caused me to be fruitful in the land of my affliction. However, when it came time to bless these two sons, Jacob crossed his arms so that he blessed Ephraim differently than he blessed Manasseh. And we will go and read of that. So Genesis chapter 48 and verse 13. And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left, and Manasseh in his left hand towards Israel's right. And he brought them near unto him. Verse 14. And Israel, meaning Jacob, stretched out his right hand and laid it upon Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head, guiding his hands wittingly. In other words, this was done for a purpose. He crossed his arms, for Manasseh was the firstborn. Verse 15. And he blessed Joseph and said, God before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac did walk, the God which fed me all my life long unto this day, verse 16, the angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads, and let my name be named on them. In other words, they would be called by the name Israel. This is how Ephraim and Manasseh come to be part of the tribes of Israel. And the name of my fathers, Abraham and Isaac. And let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. Verse 17. And when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. And he held up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head to Manasseh's head. And Joseph said unto his father, Not so, my father, for this is the firstborn. Put thy right hand upon his head. Verse 19, And his father refused and said, I know it, my son, I know it. He also shall become a people. He also shall be great, but truly his younger brother shall be greater than he. And his seed shall become a multitude of nations. And Ephraim would become a multitude of nations of the 10 tribes, but also being symbolic of the United Kingdom, which as Ephraim would be put before Manasseh and would exist first from the lost sheep of the children of the house of Israel. And in the futuristic sense, would give birth to the United States, which is symbolic of Manasseh, to which many of the nations would come and dwell and learn of God. 20. And he blessed them that day, saying, In thee shall Israel bless, saying, God make thee as Ephraim and as Manasseh. And he set Ephraim before Manasseh. Verse 21. And Israel said to Joseph, Behold, I die. But God shall be with you and bring you again into the land of your fathers. And you might make a mental note here that Joseph died in the land of Egypt. But in Exodus, when the tribes of Israel were freed from the bondage of Egypt, they carried the bones of Joseph to be buried in the land of his fathers. In other words, the land of Canaan. Verse 22, Moreover, I have given thee one portion above thy brethren, which I took out of the hand of the Amorite with my sword and with my bow. This is chapter 49 concerning these 12 sons of Jacob. So Genesis chapter 49 and verse 1. And Jacob called unto his sons and said, Gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. Keep that last days in mind. Verse 2. Gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob, and hearken unto Israel your father. Verse 3. Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellency of power. Verse 4. Unstable as water, thou shalt not excel, because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defiledest thou it. He went up to my couch. And of course, we all know what this is talking about. Verse 5. Simeon and Levi are brethren. Instruments of cruelty are in their habitations. Now, Levi would become the priest line. And the offspring of Cain would slither themselves into the tribes of Israel during the time of Joshua. They would enter in as servants, hewers of wood, and gatherers of water for the tabernacle. And through the course of events of the Bible, through the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, they would take over the priest line. It's written in Chronicles that they were the scribes. And they would become the scribes and Pharisees, the Sanhedrin, and the church of the time of Christ, which would reject him. They would call themselves Jews. Verse 6. And they would call themselves Jews because of their association with the tribes of Israel and because of dwelling in the land of Judea. Verse 6. O my soul, come not thou into their secret, unto their assembly, mine honor. Be thou not united, for in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they dig down a wall. Now, do we see a type here? Remember what I have just said about the Kenites, or the sons of Cain, entering into the tribes of Judah. In their anger they slew a man. This was a literal happening that happened to Simeon and Levi. But this literal is symbolic, because in the anger of the scribes and Pharisees, who again would infiltrate and be in the habitations of Simeon and Levi, in other words, the priest line of Levi, the scribes and Pharisees, or Sanhedrin of the time of Christ, in their anger and their blindness, would cause his death. Verse 7. Cursed be their anger, for it was fierce, and their wrath, for it was cruel. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. Now what he's saying here is, they will be divided amongst both houses, Judah and Israel, because as we know, Israel will split into two kingdoms later in the Bible. And just think about how much pain and cruelty has been caused by some in the name of religion, even in the name of Christianity, by men who have abused their authority and power in calling themselves priests, and who have dug down the wall of God's word and truth and caused it to collapse into confusion because of their own anger and self-righteousness or want for power. In this we see the cruelty of their habitations, which are also inhabited by the offspring of Cain. Verse 8. Judah, thou art whom my brethren shall praise. Or thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be on the neck of thine enemies, and thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Verse 9. Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down, he crouched as a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up? A lion's whelp, of course, is a cub. Verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come. And unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Verse 11, binding his foal unto the vine, and his ass's colt unto the choice vine. He washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. Now, let us think of the symbology of this. What is the symbology of the vine? Who is the vine? Jesus said, I am the vine, the new wine. And he shall wash his clothes in the blood of the grapes. This language is used for a very specific reason. Because through Christ, our sins are forgiven when we ask repentance, when we believe upon Him, and we are washed clean by His blood shed upon the cross. Verse 12. His eyes shall be red with wine, and his teeth white with milk. Plentiful. Verse 13. Zebulun shall dwell at the haven of the sea, and he shall be for a haven of ships, and his borders shall be unto Zidon. Verse 14. Issachar is a strong ass crouching down between two burdens. Verse 15. And he saw that rest was good, and the land that it was pleasant, and he bowed his shoulder to bear, and became a servant unto tribute. In other words, this one would bow down unto tribute rather than fight. Verse 16. Dan shall be a judge of his people, as one of the tribes of Israel. Verse 17. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path, that biteth the horse's heels so that his rider shall fall backward. And of course, the name Daniel means God is my judge. Dan means judge. Verse 18. I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord. Verse 19. Gad, a troop, shall overcome him. But he shall overcome him at the last. Verse 20. Out of Asher his bread shall be fat, and he shall yield royal dainties. Verse 21. Naphtali is a hind let loose. He giveth goodly words. Verse 22. Joseph is a fruitful bough. Even a fruitful bough by a well, whose branches run over the wall. Now, this referring to his branches are his sons. His son Ephraim's name means fruitful, and his other son Manasseh means forgetful. And the tribes of Israel would eventually forget who they were, yet they would be fruitful. Verse 13. The archers have sorely grieved him and shot at him and hated him. Verse 24. But his bow abode in strength, and his arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From thence is the shepherd and the stone of Israel. You may want to make some mental notes about this too. Who is the shepherd of Israel? Who is the stone of Israel? The rock of our salvation? Jesus Christ. Verse 25. Even by the God of thy father, who shall help thee, and by the Almighty, who shall bless thee in blessings of heaven above, blessings of the deep that lieth under, and blessings of the breasts, and blessings of the wombs, or the womb. In other words, blessings to multiply. Verse 26. The blessings of thy father have prevailed above the blessings of my progenitors, unto the utmost bound of the everlasting hills. They shall be on the head of Joseph, and on the crown of thy head of him that was separate from his brethren. This, of course, referring to Joseph being separated from his brethren because they sold him into the bondage of slavery of Egypt. Verse 27. Benjamin, which means the son of my right hand, shall raven as a wolf, and in the morning shall devour the prey, and at night shall divide the spoil. Verse 28. All these are the 12 tribes of Israel. And this is that their father spake unto them, and blessed them, every one according to his blessing he blessed them. Verse 29. And he charged them, and said unto them, I am to be gathered unto my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite. Verse 30. In the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre, in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite for possession of a burying place. Verse 31. And there they buried Abraham, Sarah, his wife, and they buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife. And there I buried Leah. Now I want you to take the first letter of each of those names, and they spell out an acrostic or a tetragrammation. Isaac, Sarah, Rebekah, Abraham, and Leah. Israel. Israel. Just something to think about. Verse 32. The purchase of the field and of the cave that is therein from the children of Heth. Verse 33. And when Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons, he gathered up his feet into the bed and yielded up the ghost, and was gathered unto his people. Now these 12 brothers and the two grandsons of one of the brothers, Joseph, were fruitful and multiplied in Egypt. So the birth of the 12 tribes happened in Egypt. And for many years they thrived in Egypt, until a new Pharaoh arose who knew not Joseph. And he took the tribes of Israel into the bondage of slavery. And this slavery in Egypt would last through several dynasties for a period of 400 years, until God heard the voice and the sufferings of his children Israel, and rose up a liberator from among them. One named Moses, whose name means drawn from the water, who had been raised as an Egyptian. And you'll see a pattern here of when they went into Israel or into Egypt, Joseph became second only to Pharaoh. And as they exit Egypt in the Exodus, we have Moses, who was raised as a son of Pharaoh, dropping back down to Israel. Again, something to think about. But Moses had been raised an Egyptian, and God revealed the truth to him at the burning bush and told him to go before Pharaoh. And through God's mighty power and his servant Moses, God would free Israel from their burdens in Egypt. But no sooner had the Israelites been freed from that bondage that they turned and began to murmur against Moses and against God, and to worship false idols. And for this, God destroyed a multitude of them. The rest he left to wander in the desert for a period of 40 years, until all that generation of idolaters and murmurers had died off. It is amazing how Israel could or would have done these things after all the things they had witnessed at the hand of God. The 10 plagues, the parting of the Red Sea, being fed quail and manna in the desert, being given water from the stone, having a cloud over them by day so that they weren't burned in the desert sun, and having a pillar of fire to protect them and light them by night. Nevertheless, the Israelites did finally enter into the Promised Land, where the modern state of Israel exists today. But in the Old Testament, God promised repeatedly that for Israel's transgressions, he would scatter them abroad and disperse them to the four winds, meaning the four directions. And over the course of time, this would happen. But now let's jump ahead in timeline to a period when Israel had split into two separate kingdoms. The kingdom of Judah, comprised mostly of the tribes of Judah and Benjamin, with its capital at Jerusalem, and the kingdom of the other 10 tribes to the north, with its capital in Samaria. Samaria meaning Watch Mountain. And Samaria would be the name that the 10 northern tribes of Israel would be called by. And as I had alluded to, in the time of Joshua, strangers had infiltrated into the tribes of Israel by deceitful means. And by the books of Ezra and Nehemiah had taken over the priesthood and began calling themselves Jews. However, they were not of the children of Israel by seed line or bloodline. They were of the seed line of Cain, but that is another subject for another time. Now Samaria and Judah bickered back and forth and fought and warred against each other, brother against brother. And this also will be a recurring theme amongst the tribes of Israel. This curse or this bickering would follow them everywhere they wandered and migrated to, as we will see as we continue in the study. We know that after the captivity of Egypt and after of the settling of the land, the Promised Land, and the split between the two kingdoms of Israel, that there were two further captivities of the tribes of Israel in biblical times. The first captivity to Samaria, Israel, to the kingdom of Assyria, and which happened around the year 600 BC by corrected timeline. Then 150 years later, around 450 BC, would come the captivity of Judah, Israel, to the kingdom of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. Now the tribe of Judah, during their captivity, were allowed to remain in their homeland, that is, those who obeyed God and did not flee from Nebuchadnezzar. And we know that the tribe of Judah, even after that captivity of 70 years, would remain in the land of Judea and be there even during the time of Christ. And they dwelled there until the great destruction of Jerusalem by Rome in 69 AD by Titus. And this is when the great diaspora, or dispersal, of the tribe of Judah happened. But whereas the Jews retained their identity, many of them later migrating to Europe, and with good reason, the other 10 tribes of the north did not retain their identity after their captivity to Assyria. At least they didn't retain it for very long. Now the kingdom of Assyria, which took the 10 northern tribes captive, was based in the land of Syria. That is to say, modern-day Syria, though it extended beyond the borders of Syria. And the Babylonian kingdom, made up of the Chaldees or the Chaldeans, was based in Babylon, again, which is modern-day Iraq, Abraham's native land. Now, the captivity of Samaria, Israel, happened when the Assyrians invaded Samaria and took the 10 northern tribes of Israel, Samaria, captive. But they took Samaria away. They did not leave them in their homeland. And it is during these years of that captivity and the short time after that the tribes of Israel, the 10 northern tribes that is, Samaria, began to be lost to us in biblical writings. And even lost to history as far as man's remembrance. Yet they were known about, even during the time of Christ and the apostles, for Peter and Paul would both travel abroad from the land of Judea on missions to their lost brethren. When the captivity of Samaria, Israel did finally come to an end, the people now freed did not go back to their homeland. Rather, they went forth from Assyria north and west, crossing through the nation of Turkey into the mountain range known as the Caucasus Mountains. And they adopted the name of that mountain range, that mountainous region, and became called the Caucasians, after the name of the area of the land that they migrated into and dwelled in. Let us go now to the book of Daniel, chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 3. And Daniel chapter 9 verse 3 reads, I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplication and with fasting and sackcloth of ashes. Verse 4. And I prayed unto the Lord my God and made my confession and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy with them that love him and to them that keep his commandments. Verse 5. We have sinned and committed iniquity and have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from thy precepts and thy judgments. Verse 6. Neither have we hearkened unto thy servants the prophets which spake in thy name to our kings, our princes, and to our fathers, and to all the people of the land. Verse 7. O Lord, righteousness belongeth to thee, but to us confusion of faces, meaning they would forget who they were, they would not know who they were, as it is to this day, to the men of Judah, and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and to all Israel. There are reasons there that those are separated. To all Israel that are near and afar off, through all the countries where thou hast driven them, because of their trespass they have trespassed against thee. Now that tells you right there that it was known that they had been driven to other countries. Verse 8. O Lord, to us belongeth confusion of face. Again, don't know who they are. To our kings, to our princes, to our fathers, because we have sinned against thee. Verse 9. To the Lord belongeth mercies and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him. Yet God's promise to Abraham was fulfilled, And this people would multiply as the stars of the heavens and the sands upon the seashores, both in the house of Israel, Judah, and the house of Israel, Samaria, which by this time was now losing its identity. As the 10 northern tribes of Israelites, once called Samaria, began to grow in numbers, they started migrating away from the Caucasus mountain range, again north and west, into Eurasia towards Europe. And as the years passed, they continued migrating farther and farther and became called by different tribe names. No longer were they called by the name Israel, but instead they took upon themselves new names. Yet, even today, we can trace them because of the clues left in history as they followed their destiny. They crossed out of the Caucasus into the land called Scythia. It is now called Scythia. It was once called Scythia. And for a short time after they left the Caucasus mountain range, they were called Sarmatians, because of their former captors, the Assyrians' custom of transposing letters in speech. Yet, as they dwelled in these new lands, by the Romans and by the natives, they were still referred to as Sumerians. And as the many different pronunciations of the land, different dialects, in other words, of pre-Europe, the Sumerians would be pronounced as Cimmerians or Cimmerians, the Cimmeri, Gimmerians or the Gimmeri, or Gimmerans. The word Gimmerans eventually evolved into the word Germanics, the Germanic tribes, which were called by the Romans as Barbarians, which is a play on their former name, Sumerians. As they moved ever and ever farther, they became known as the Scythian Israelites, Scythian Israel. Scythia, or Scythia, of course, coming from the word Sakai, meaning Isaac's, referring to Jacob's father and the seed by which they were called. The pronunciation was Sakai-thien, which in a short time became pronounced Scythian or Scythian. And later, from those words would come the word Saxon or Saxonis, which is where the word Saxon comes from. And Saxuni, which is the former name of Saxony. And as these people still dwelled and migrated, unbeknownst to them, they would reunite with other members of their own family of the tribes of Israel. And again, would become one people, the people of Europe, that is. They would not become a united nation, but they would become a people united again. Now, it is common knowledge that the Saxons founded places like Saxony, Germany, but the fact that they ended up in Britain shows the direction they were headed. They would, in fact, mix with the Angles and become the Anglo-Saxons. And this would show how the Anglos and the Saxons mixed together. And, of course, there would be power struggles between the Anglos and the Saxons, and once the Anglo-Saxons had bonded together, then there would be struggles between the Normans and the Saxons, and the Normans also from that seed line of Israel. Others of their same Israelite heritage who were also migrating were called the Iberians, another name given by Rome. This was a mixture of the word Eber and Aryan. Iberian. Iber comes from the word Eber, Eber meaning Hebrew. So what you've got here is the word Hebrew Sumerians. Iberia is located where modern-day Spain is. But this is where we get into a little bit of a touchy subject. This is where the root word Aryan comes in. And this, amongst many people, is a dirty word. And it is a dirty word because of what happened in World War II and pre-World War II by the Nazis. And rampant decades of racism by neo-Nazis and skinhead extremists. The simple use of the word Aryan now has an ugly, undeserved stigma which has been put upon it. And that stigma was put upon it by blinded fools such as Adolf Hitler, who in his maniacal dictatorship and lust for genocide, and in his arrogance, totally missed the connection between Sumerians and Aryans, as he sent his generals and his scientists and his so-called objective students of history out to find the Aryan roots. And in his blind stupidity, Adolf Hitler let Germany into a frenzied mob bent on the extinction of their brothers, the tribe of Judah. Germany, before Hitler's rise to power, had been a Christian nation. And simply because of Hitler's actions, only 70-some-odd years ago, and the ignorant anarchists who have idolized him even to this day, the word Aryan has now become a dirty word connected with racism by false association. Because the word Aryan was around long before it ever was muddied by the stigma put upon it by the Nazis, the socialists, skinheads, and neo-Nazis. But there are those now who can't get past the word Aryan being associated with Nazism, neo-Nazism, and just plain old racism. Though Aryan, by itself, the word has nothing to do with racism other than the false stigma and false association placed upon it all those years ago. But now, let's get back to Israel's migrations and their tribal names. We were talking about the Iberians. This, again, was a name given to them by Rome. Iber is the Latin pronunciation of the word Eber, which we heard earlier, which means Hebrews, which was a name that had stuck to them since Abraham crossed over the waters. So Iberia, fully translated, means land of the Hebrews. This is why many of the Jews during the diaspora migrated into the lands of Europe to be amongst their brethren. But even in medieval times, because of what happened, because of what the Kenites caused to happen to Christ, the Jews were seen as infidels because they did not worship Christ. And even to this day, that stigma also still exists. But again, Iberia is where modern Spain exists today. As the years and the centuries passed, the tribes of Israel kept on migrating and crossing Europe. And they became known by more recognizable and more latter names, such as the Celts, the Gaelics, the Goths, both sects of the Goths, the Ostrogoths, which means the Eastern Goths, and the Visigoths, which means the Western Goths, the Franks or Francos, the Picts, the Jutes, the Belgae, the Lombard, the Basques, the Pacts, the Danes, the Britons, the Huns. And actually, Israel was not part of the Huns, per se. The Huns were a people of Asia. But the Huns did come in to the Aryan lands, and there's that word again, and formed the nation of Hungary. Hungary is a word based upon the word Hungarian. In other words, the Huns and the Aryans. Again, of Hunnish and Aryan or Sumerian descent. And as time progressed, these aforementioned names became known by the more familiar names we are all familiar with now. The Scots, the Irish, the English, the Norse, the Welsh, the Spaniards, the Cornish, the French, the Swedes, the Ottomans, and so on. And here is a list of some of the tribes that are descended of the 10 northern tribes of Israel. There are other smaller tribes and sub-tribes which are not listed in this. And of course, there were other white races which dwelled in Europe in even more ancient times. But the vast majority of modern Europeans are made up of the 10 northern tribes of Israel on their migrations. As they migrated and mixed into Europe, they lost knowledge of themselves and fell into pagan worship and false religions and believed in superstitions like witchcraft, medieval sorcery, and other such mythical things. This is a lot of the reason for dragons and griffins and gargoyles and such things in the history of Europe. Yet even though they had fallen into pagan worship, they were still the lost sheep of the children of the house of Israel. But along with the lost sheep of the children of the house of Israel, also sojourned those of the seed line of Cain. And we will go into that a little bit more later. There are overwhelming amounts of proof of these migrations of Israel into Europe and into their dwelling places in Europe, in the historical documents of Europe. One such document is the Scottish Declaration of Independence, called the Declaration of Arbroath, written in the year 1320. Another is the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle. They can also be found among the state seals and declarations of many nations. And in the symbologies of the peoples. But let us go now and read from the Scottish Declaration of Independence of Arbroath, again written in the year 1320, which declares the Scots lineage in their own words as being of the tribes of Israel. And here are the words to that declaration. Most Holy Father and Lord, we know, and from the books and chronicles of the ancients we find that amongst other famous nations, our own, the Scots, have been graced with widespread renown. They journeyed from Scythia, by way of the Tyrrhenian Sea, and by the Pillars of Hercules, and dwelt for a long course of time in Spain amongst the most savage of tribes. But nowhere could they be subdued by any race, no matter how barbarous. Thence they came. 1,200 years after the departure of the children of Israel, they came to dwell in the west, where we now dwell. The Britons were driven out, the Picts were utterly destroyed, and we were assailed again and again by the Norse, the Danes, and the English. But by many a victory and with endless toil, we established ourselves here. And as the historians of old bear witness, we have held our land free of servitude of every kind. Within this realm, there have reigned 113 kings of our royal native dynasty, not one of alien birth. If proof be needed of the worth of this people, it shines forth for all to see in this, that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, after his passion and resurrection, chose us as almost the first to be called to his most holy faith. Now let us remember the words of Genesis 22 and the promises that we have covered to Abraham, to Isaac, and even to Joseph's sons. And let us keep in mind what was just spoken in this document about their royal native seed line that was not breached by foreign influence. In other words, their seed line was pure and unbroken. Mentioned also in this document is the departure of the children of Israel 1,200 years earlier from Scythia by way of the Tyrrhenian Sea, now called the Mediterranean Sea, and by the Pillars of Hercules, which are now called the Straits of Gibraltar, between Morocco on the African continent and Spain on the European continent. also mentioned was the fact that other nations know and claim Israel as their heritage due to the ancient chronicles and the historians which have kept records. And again, these there are historical evidence that are in the state seals of many of the countries of Europe and in the writings of the countries of Europe which prove this. There is a book called Zebulun, Strange Parallel of the People of Holland and the Netherlands with the Lost Tribes of Israel. It's a very interesting book. Well worth reading. Now let us read a short quote from the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, which states, "Be kind to strangers in your land, and never forget that you were once 400 years in the bondage of Egypt." That's from the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle of the Sakathians, the sons of Isaac, the Sumerian Israelites. And let us also take note of some things that I think God has set forth so that we can recognize these tribes. The tribe of Dan occupied the most northern lands back when the tribes were given their land allotment in the Promised Land. And as the tribe of Dan migrated, they also occupied the most northern lands of Europe. Look at this chart concerning Dan. From the tribe of Dan, we've got the people of the Danube, which is the river Danube, that were called the Danes or the Danish. And in reflective pronunciations, the name Dan is used as the name Den, as in Denmark, which was once pronounced Danmark. The word Den is also found in the word Sweden, which is a mixture of the Swithoids and the Danes. The Swithoids also founding Switzerland and becoming the Swiss. And the pronunciation Den, D-I-N, in the name of Scandinavia, who also came from this same group of Danes. Not to mention the mixing of the Celtic with this group. And these people would become the Northmen, or the Norsemen. And the Norsemen, when they went about to pillage and to be the pirates of their times, would say, "We are gone a Viking," which is where the name the Vikings came from. And another similarity, these peoples of Scandinavia, Sweden, the Danes, so on, have no J in their alphabet, but pronounce J as Y, just as the Hebrew language. Mere coincidence? I think not. Look at the shipbuilding techniques of the Phoenicians, which are also of Israel from the early centuries just after Samaria. And compare their ships to the Viking Drakkar longboats. Both are open-top, low-draft vehicles so that they could travel into shallow waters. Both have a center-mounted mast and sail. Both have a rudder and oars in the same exact placement. Again, coincidence? Extremely doubtful. Not to mention that the Phoenician alphabet is almost exactly identical to the Hebrew alphabet. It has 22 characters with the same sounds and values, and only a slight variation in how the letters are drawn out, which is hardly discernible. Also, the early languages of Libyan and Iberian bear the same characters. Now let's take into consideration the words of Christ to his disciples. We're going to turn over to the book of Matthew, chapter 10 and verse 5. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 5. "These 12 Jesus sent forth." Now, if you have any doubt as to who it's talking about here, these are his 12 disciples. the word apostle means ones sent forth. So that's who's being referred here. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and to any city of the Samaritans enter ye not. The Samaritans were the people that supplanted the Samaritans and took their land. The Samaritans were not of the tribes of Israel. Verse 6, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, during the time of Jesus, the Jews, being again Judah and Benjamin, were still there in the land of Judea. And Christ is sending these 12 to the lost sheep of the children of the house of Israel. And if we look at maps of the travels of Peter, who was sent but to the lost sheep of the children of the house of Israel, and the routes of travel taken by Paul, who was sent to the house of Israel and to the Gentile, we can see the routes they took along the old Roman landscape towards Rome and towards Europe to spread the gospel. Now let's look at some other similarities. You may recall from the famous movie The Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston and Yul Brynner that Moses wore a distinctive colored robe to signify his seed line as being of the house of Levi, the tribe of Levi. The movie romanticizes this, however, the practice of tribal seed line distinction by use of colors and lines upon clothing and robes was very real. And this practice would be adhered to even as the tribes of Israel who left Samaria migrated into Europe. And here are some examples of the practice by the Judean family clothing, which denote family seed lines. In other words, of the tribe of Judah. And here are European and Britannic examples of clothing which denote family seed lines and or tribes or clans, and it's called tartan. Tartan has roots which go back much farther than most people are aware of. And it spanned the families of the European tribes, and this would also later translate into family crests and symbols of heraldry, of nobility. But now let's look at even some more compelling facts. Let us consider Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II of the United Kingdom. Very few know the royal family's lineage beyond a few generations, but there is an unbroken seed line of this royal family which goes all the way back to King David of Israel, of Judah, and actually even precedes that and goes all the way back to Eth Ha Adam himself, meaning Adam, the husband of Eve. There are 153 generations from Adam to Queen Elizabeth II. But how did David's throne, the throne of Judah, the throne of Israel, come to be located in Britain? Well, to understand this, let's go back to King David, who as a boy slew Goliath and rose up to be the second king of Israel after Saul, and see that God promised King David that his seed would forever sit upon the throne of Israel. Then we will see how David's throne eventually came to be located in Britain. In the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 7 and verse 8, it is written, now therefore shalt thou say unto my servant David, this would be the words of God to Nathan, thus saith, or to Nathanael, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from a sheepcote, in other words a shepherd, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people Israel. Verse 9, and I was with thee whithersoever thou wentest, and have cut off all thy enemies out of thy sight, and have made thee a great name. likened unto the name of the great men that are in the earth. Verse 10. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more. Neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them any more, as before time. This, of course, looking towards the future. Verse 11. And as since that time I have commanded the judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused them to rest from all thine enemies, also the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house. Verse 12. And when thy days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, in other words, when David dies, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, or his body, and I will establish his kingdom. And he shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father. Verse 14. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commit iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men, and with the stripes of the children of men. Verse 15. But my mercy shall not depart away from him, as I took from Saul, whom I put away before thee. Verse 16. And thine house and thine kingdom shall be established forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. In other words, from David's time on, the throne would exist forever. Now we know Solomon would come from David's bowels or body as his seed, and he would build God's temple. But in the bigger picture, it is Christ that was the house or the temple of God, and who shall reign over Israel, and indeed over all, forever. And though Christ did not commit iniquity, he would take on the sins of all and suffer the stripes of the children of men in his scourging and crucifixion. Yet, when Christ departed, he promised he would return. And until Christ returns for his throne, the seed of David does still sit upon the throne. As Christians, who many are the seed of Israel, which have spread the good news, which was foretold, that the seed of Isaac would be a blessing to all nations. Now let's turn over to Isaiah 62, and we're going to read from there. Isaiah chapter 62, and verse 1, and it reads, For Zion's sake I will not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest, until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. Verse 2. And the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory. And thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. What name are we talking about here? Christians. For it was God that named Emmanuel, meaning God dwelling with man, referring to Christ. Verse 3. Thou shalt also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. Verse 4. Thou shalt no more be termed forsaken, neither shall thy land any more be termed desolate, but thou shalt be called Hephzibah. Hephzibah in Hebrew meaning my delight is in her, and thy land Beulah, which is to say married. For the Lord delighteth in thee, and thy land shall be married. It kind of explains itself at the end of the verse there. Verse 5. For as a young man marrieth a virgin, so shall thy sons marry thee. And as the bridegroom rejoiceth over the bride, so shall thy God rejoice over thee. The bridegroom, of course, symbolically speaking of Christ. So from these verses, we know that David's kingdom would be established forever. And David, of course, being the kingdom, or the king of Judah, and over that kingdom. However, we know in the book of Jeremiah that the kingdom of Judah would fall because of the transgressions of the kings and the men thereof. Because King Zedekiah, the last king of Judah, and the men of Judah hearkened not to God, which through Jeremiah had told them to remain in Judah and to go into captivity of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. But instead, Zedekiah attempted to flee and was overtaken and captured. We will pick this up now in Jeremiah chapter 39 and verse 4. So turn over to Jeremiah 39 and verse 4, and we will read. And verse 4 reads, "And it came to pass that when Zedekiah the king of Judah saw them," meaning the Chaldeans, the Babylonians, "and all the men of war, then they fled, and went forth out of the city by night, by way of the king's garden, and betwixt the two walls. And he went out by the way of the plain." Verse 5. "But the Chaldeans," which is the Babylonians, "army pursued after them and overtook Zedekiah in the plains of Jericho. And when they had taken him, they brought him up to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, to Riblah, in the land of Hamath, where he gave judgment upon him." Verse 6. "And the king of Babylon slew the sons of Zedekiah in Riblah before his eyes. Also the king of Babylon slew all the nobles of Judah. Moreover," verse 7, "moreover he put out Zedekiah's eyes and bound him with chains and carried him to Babylon." Now there is a type here. Can you spot it? No eyes to see, being put into the bondage of chains and carried away to Babylon. Babylon fully interpreted meaning confusion because of what happened at the Tower of Babel. But also we see that Zedekiah's male heirs, his sons, were killed. However, Zedekiah had daughters, which were not killed. We will read of them later. Verse 8. "And the Chaldeans burned the king's house and the houses of the people with fire and break down the walls of Jerusalem." Verse 9. "Then Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, carried away captive into Babylon the remnant of the people that remained in the city. And those that fell away, that fell to him, and the rest of the people that remained." Verse 10. "But Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, left of the poor of the people, which had nothing, in the land of Judea, and gave them vineyards and fields at the same time." In other words, who we're talking about here is the ones that did not flee. The ones that did not flee were taken into the captivity, but were not taken away to the land of Babylon. They obeyed God and remained in the land of Judea. This would also be symbolic of God's election, who obey the voice of God and do not flee, but go into the captivity of the king of Babylon to come and give testimony against him when they are delivered up. Verse 11. "Now Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, gave charge concerning Jeremiah to Nebuzaradan, captain of the guard, saying," verse 12, "take him, and look well to him, and do him no harm, but do unto him as he shall say unto thee." In other words, obey him. Verse 13. "So Nebuzaradan and the captain of the guard sent, and Nebuhashban, Rabsaris, Nergal Shazarezer, Rabmag, and all the king of Babylon's princesses," or princes, verse 14, "even they sent and took Jeremiah out of the court of prison and committed him to Gedaliah the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, that he should carry him home. So he dwelt among the people. Verse 15. Now the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah while he was shut up in the court of the prison, saying, verse 16, go and speak to Ebed-Melech, the Ethiopian, saying, thus saith the Lord God of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring my words upon this city for evil and not for good, and they shall be accomplished in that day before thee. In other words, you'll witness it. Verse 17. But I will deliver thee in that day, saith the Lord, and thou shalt be not given into the hand of the men who thou art afraid. Verse 18. For surely I will deliver thee, and thou shalt not fall by the sword, but thy life shall be a prey unto thee, because thou hast put thy trust in me, saith the Lord. In other words, we've seen Jeremiah spared here, and basically the people who have obeyed God. The ones that disobeyed God, not going to be so lucky. Just as Zedekiah was not so lucky and all of his male heirs. But in chapter 43 of the book of Jeremiah, we have record that the men of Judah which did flee to Egypt took Jeremiah and the king's daughters. This would be the daughters of Zedekiah. And they went to Tophonis, Egypt. And we can place them there during this time. So Jeremiah chapter 43 and verse 1. And it came to pass that when Jeremiah had made an end of speaking unto all the people, all the words of the Lord their God, for which the Lord their God had sent him to them, even all those words, verse 2, then spake Azariah, the son of Hoshaiah, the son of Johanan, the son of Kareah, and all the proud men, saying unto Jeremiah, thou speakest falsely. The Lord our God hath not sent thee to say, go not into Egypt to sojourn there. In other words, they're calling Jeremiah a liar. They're saying, God has not spoken to you. This is very similar to how many churches teach today, believe it or not. Verse 3. But this will be them continuing to speak. But Baruch, the son of Neriah, setteth thee on against us, for to deliver us into the hand of the Chaldeans, that they might put us to death and carry us away captives into Babylon. Verse 4. So Johanan, the son of Kareah, and all the captains of the forces, and all the people, obeyed not the voice of the Lord to dwell in the land of Judah. In other words, they didn't stay in Judah as they were ordered to by God. But Johanan, the son of Kareah, and all the captains from the forces, took the remnant of Judah that were returned from all the nations, whither they had been driven, to dwell in the land of Judah. Verse 6, even men, women, and children, and the king's daughters, and every person that Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, had left with Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, and Jeremiah the prophet, and Baruch, the son of Neriah. This would be Baruch, Jeremiah's scribe, quite frankly. Verse 7, so they came into the land of Egypt, and they obeyed not the voice of the Lord. Thus came they even to Tophonis. Now, we're in Tophonis, Egypt here. Jeremiah and his scribe, Baruch, the daughters of Zedekiah, and all these men. Verse 8. Then came the word of the Lord unto Jeremiah in Tophonis, saying, verse 9, take great stones in thy hand, and hide them in the clay, in the bricklin, which is in the entry of Pharaoh's house at Tophonis, in the sight of the men of Judah. In other words, do it in front of them. Verse 10. And say unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will send and take Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant. You want to remember that. And will set his throne upon these stones that I have hid. And he shall spread his royal pavilion over them. Verse 11. And when he cometh, he shall smite the land of Egypt, and deliver such as for death to death, and as such as for captivity to captivity, and as such as for the sword to the sword. Verse 12. And I will kindle the fire in the houses of the gods of Egypt, and he shall burn them, and carry them away captives. And he shall array himself in the land of Egypt, as a shepherd putteth on his garment. He shall go forth from thence in peace. You want to catch a type here of the king of Babylon to come, the king of confusion, which is, of course, Satan, the Antichrist. And what he will do to those that worship false gods, or those who do not know the truth. Verse 13. He shall break the images at Beth Shemesh, that is in the land of Egypt, and in the houses of the gods of the Egyptians he shall burn with fire. In Jeremiah chapter 46 and verse 25, it reads, The Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, saith, Behold, I will punish the multitude of No and Pharaoh in Egypt with their gods and their kings, even Pharaoh and all the men that trust in him. Verse 26, And I will deliver them into the hands of those that seek their lives, and into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and into the hand of his servants. And afterwards it shall be inhabited, as in the days of old, saith the Lord. Verse 27. But fear thou not, O my servant Jacob, and be thou not dismayed, O Israel, for behold, I will save thee from afar off, and thy seed from the land of their captivity. And Jacob shall return and be in rest and at ease, and none shall make him afraid. Now I want you to remember the words of that verse, that he would save the seed from the land of their captivity, which means Babylon. You got a twofold meaning in that. First of all, the daughters of Zedekiah, who would be the seed of Zedekiah, the seed of David. And then, of course, the seed of the children of Israel, from the king of Babylon to come. Verse 28. Fear thou not, O Jacob my servant, saith the Lord, for I am with thee. For I will make a full end to all the nations whither I have driven thee. But I will not make a full end of thee, but correct thee in measure. Yet I will not leave thee wholly unpunished. Again, this is the trademark of God to correct his children, especially those of the seed of Jacob, Israel. But this is where the biblical references to the remnant of Judah, meaning the seed line, the throne of David, end. And history tells us the rest. For in Tophonis, Egypt, to this day, there stands a ruin inscribed with the words, The daughters of Judah dwelt here. And we know that in Ireland, just after these events, would come a man who would be called Olam Fala, which means the great prophet or great teacher, who had a scribe and brought with him two daughters of a royal noble seed line. On the eventual tomb of this Olam Fala is his scribe seal, and it is identical to the seal of Baruch, the scribe of Jeremiah. So Olam Fala is what turns out to be Jeremiah the prophet. And he brought to Ireland the two daughters of this royal bloodline of the king of Judah, which eventually set up a new kingdom at Tara. And the arrival of Olamfala in Ireland coincides perfectly with the disappearance of Jeremiah the prophet and the daughters of Zedekiah, the last king of Judah. One of these daughters of Zedekiah was named Scotes or Scota, which is where the name Scotland would eventually come from. Previous to this migration, the land of Scotland had been called Caledonia. There is also an analogy given in figs. Figs in the Bible are always symbolic of Israel, the good fig, and the bad fig, as mentioned in Jeremiah 24, and that which is hidden, as in Adam and Eve sewed fig leaves together to try to cover their sin from God. But a fig tree is not planted by seeds. Rather, a shoot is cut off from the adult tree and is planted in new fertile ground and becomes a new tree. Much in the same way that this kingdom of Terah came forth from Zedekiah's daughters, which were cut off from Judah and planted in Ireland, but as God had promised, he would save the seed. And eventually, the kingdom would move to Scotland and then to Britain. Let's also take note of the Hebrides Islands above Scotland, above that former land called Caledonia, which was named for Scota, the daughter of Zedekiah, Ttephi. How do you suppose the Hebrides got their name? Comes from the same word, Eber, Hebrews. There are other pieces of evidence to support this, such as the Stone of Scoon, which is also called the Stone of Destiny. This was the stone Jacob used as a pillar. It is the stone that he dreamed the dream of Jacob's ladder upon and anointed, which was kept with the tribes of Israel and by all the kings of Judah. It was one of the holy items. No doubt, whenever the tribe of Judah fell, it was carried with Jeremiah to Ireland and then to Scotland, where it became called the Stone of Scone. And then eventually it was moved to Westminster Abbey and placed in a throne there, where all the monarchs of Scotland and England and Wales and France have come and sat upon this very stone, again mounted in a throne chair, to be coronated. As mentioned in the Scottish Declaration, all of their kings had been of their royal native dynasty, not one of alien birth. But as further documentation, at some point I will post the unbroken seed line or royal king line of ascension of Adam right down to Queen Elizabeth, which again is 150 generations. And here are some documentations of the pillar, which would eventually become the Stone of Scone, over its long existence. I might also add that pieces of this stone have been taken and tested, and its origin has been found to be the Middle East. It is from the exact land where Jacob had his dream. Tests have revealed that the stone came from the same location, that this stone is not native to Britain or even to Europe. We also know that God promised that one day these two kingdoms, Israel and Judah, would be reunited and restored. So now let's go to the book of Jeremiah chapter 50 and read a little bit from there. This will be to further document Israel's scattering. Jeremiah chapter 50 and verse 17. Israel is a scattered sheep. The lions have driven him away. First the king of Assyria hath devoured him, and last the king, and last this Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, hath broken his bones. Verse 18. Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will punish the king of Babylon in his land, as I have punished the king of Assyria. Now, this next verse is future even to us. It has not come to pass yet, because only some of the tribe of Judah have thus far returned and set up a nation in Israel. This next verse concerns the millennium age and beyond. In 1948, though, as written in Jeremiah 24, there was the planting of the good and bad fig. Verse 19, and I will bring Israel again into his habitation, and he shall feed upon Carmel and Bashan, and his soul shall be satisfied upon Mount Ephraim and Gilead. Verse 20, and in those days, in that time, saith the Lord, the iniquity of Israel shall be sought for, and there shall be none. The sins of Judah, and they shall not be found, for I will pardon them whom I reserve. Now this obviously shows you that this cannot happen until the millennium, because man's sins are always many. But now we're going to go and look at the family crest of Queen Elizabeth II. We're going to look at some of the symbology contained therein. And we will also look at their forebearers' crests and see the symbology of this royal seed line. This royal family's origins extend throughout all the royal families of Europe. Indeed, even to Tsar Nicholas Romanov of Russia, the last king of Russia, or Tsar. The word Tsar is the same word as Caesar, as is the word Kaiser. Tsar Nicholas Romanov of Russia was a grandson of Queen Victoria. But now let's look at the royal family crest of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth Regina Windsor, Mountbatten. As we look at this royal family crest, we see written in Latin the family motto, Deo et Mondroit, which translated into English means God and my right. Why is it their right? Or why is it Queen Elizabeth's right? Because she is of that royal seed line, as mentioned in the Scottish Declaration of Independence. Not one of alien birth. And look at the lion, symbolic to the English of England, which came down from Scotland and Ireland in heraldry. The unicorn, symbolic of Scotland. The harp, symbolic of Ireland, and the red dragon, symbolic of Wales. In an earlier version of this study, I had said the red dragon was symbolic of Scotland, and that was because of a number of studies I was doing at the time, where in Scottish nobility, the red dragon was very prevalent. But what is the deeper symbology? What do we glean from these heraldry symbols? Well, first of all, what is the lion symbolic of in the Bible? What was said to Judah? The lion is of Judah. It is the symbol used by the tribes of Israel. And the lion's place was always to the right, even in the land allotment. And when Israel was in the desert, Judah was always to the right. The unicorn, symbolic of the tribe of Ephraim, and their placement here together on this shield the lion in a place of prominence. On the right-hand side, that is to say, if you're holding the shield, and the unicorn on the left-hand side. And their presence together, a symbol of unity, or the marriage of these two. In other words, the tribe of Judah and the tribe of Ephraim. The smaller lion on the crown is symbolic of where this seed line began, back in the land of Judea. But there are two further clues. In Genesis chapter 9, we read that Judah is a lion's whelp, meaning a cub. Hence, the small lion on the crown. And the three lions on the shield are all crouching, as spoken by Jacob, who was called Israel when speaking of Judah. So then, the three lions are symbolic of the tribe of Judah. The red dragon has several symbologies. First, being symbolic of the seed of Cain, who would travel along with Israel and scattered amongst the people of Israel. The red dragon, even mentioned in the book of Revelation, is persecuting the woman who brought forth the man-child, meaning Mother Israel. And the harp of David, symbolic of the families of this bloodline, which passed through Ireland, where the harp is symbolic, through Scotland, and down to England. The two roses, symbolic, and even used on the throne of David and Solomon, and the base firmly planted on a field of clovers, symbolic of Ireland, where this people came to dwell in the land of Terah, where this kingdom was replanted to. Former crests from the past, we see this same royal bloodline, and we see more symbologies. In the older crest of Queen Elizabeth Regina I, we see the standard of France included, which is not on the current royal crest, except in Canada, because France is, of course, no longer part of the United Kingdom. But where are these three lions? Where do they come from on the shield? Well, they came forth in ages past from King Richard. As we discovered in the Scottish Declaration of Independence of Arbroath in 1320, the Scots knew their heritage even in the year 1320. So it is not hard to imagine that King Richard the Lionhearted, which was at an even earlier time, also knew his family's lineage. Which is one of the reasons why Richard quested in the Crusades to go and recapture his ancestors' beloved Jerusalem from the Arab Moors, which he would have seen as infidels. Incidentally, during this time, if you have seen movies or read the books such as Ivanhoe, you will see that there was a disdain for the Jewish, even in that time, who were not Christians. But Richard's battle shield bears these three lions, of course, symbolic of the tribe of Judah. And of course, the Knights Templar, which spawned of these crusades, would bring forth many legends of the quest for the Holy Grail, which are also symbologies for the blood of this seed line. For in communion we partake of the wine symbolic of the blood of Christ. And the Holy Grail is said to be the actual cup used in the Last Supper for communion, which these knights sought after. But it's more likely that this cup was a symbology, in this case of the hidden seed line, the bloodline, which was lost to man's remembrance over the millennia, of this Judah royal scarlet bloodline of the royalty of Judah. Is it any coincidence that it would be a king of this seed line, King James, which would order the Bible translated in the year 1611. The royal family take part in a large number of ceremonies every year which commemorate the traditions of their Israelite heritage. Some of these are covered in the books by E. Raymond Capp called The Traditions of Glastonbury, The Stone of Destiny, and The Abrahamic Covenant. E. Raymond Capp was one of the world's foremost biblical archaeologists. There is also the book called Judah's Scepter by J.H. Allen. There is also a book called Tracing Our Ancestry, which is a little booklet which also outlines the migrations of the children of Israel. There are also ties that have been found between all of these people by Dr. Barry Fell, who was the world's foremost epigrapher. In other words, an expert on language patterns and the geographies they came from. And it would be through the vast British Empire that many of the ethnic nations would come to know Christ and hear the good news. As Britain stretched out to other nations and other countries and became colonies in Canada, in America, Australia, India, large parts of Africa, even China. Now finally, let's look to the Americas and the symbologies found there. According to what is commonly taught, America was discovered by Columbus in 4992. But it is now more widely known than it has been that this is not quite the truth. For America had been visited long before Columbus and even before the birth of Christ by many different peoples, including Hebrews, Romans, Greeks, various members of the 12 tribes who were unaware of their ancestry, and in latter years, even peoples from the north, the Vikings, and other peoples, even Russians and Mongols from other heritages. But these are not taught as part of history, because there is a long-standing controversy between Columbian history and actual history. However, let's begin by looking into America at the first established colonies. According to history, the first settlement in America was Jamestown, founded in 1607. Of course, named for the king, but the Greek translation for James is Jacob. Just another odd coincidence? Probably not. Britain established 13 colonies in America. 13 in biblical numerics is symbolic of rebellion. It's also symbolic of the tribes of Israel, if you count the half-tribe of Ephraim and Manasseh. And indeed, these 13 colonies did rebel and won their independence from Britain. But within less than 100 years, America had another war, the Civil War, where 13 Confederate states rebelled against 13 Union states for division of the Union. Israel fighting brother and brother once again, as they had done for centuries in Europe with the Clan Wars, the wars between England and France, England and Spain, and all the wars in Europe over land or religion. And again, 13 also symbolic, as I had alluded to the number of the tribes of Israel, with the split of the half-tribe of Ephraim and Manasseh. Manasseh, of course, the 13th tribe. seeing as Joseph had no tribe, but his portion was passed on to his sons Ephraim and Manasseh. Incidentally, another of the early settlements in Virginia, this virgin land, was called Manassas, where a famous Civil War battle occurred. Sounds very much like Manasseh. Also Norfolk. Norfolk, people of the North. And look at the symbology in our own standards and ensigns and heraldry. Take the American flag. 13 stripes and a royal field of blue, which now hold 50 stars. Remember, I told you earlier to keep stars in mind. The stars of heaven and the sands of the seashore. Have these people not crossed over many waters to reach this nation? This nation blessed by God because of our loyalty to Him? Our pledge says, one nation under God. Our currency says, in God we trust. And look at the great seal of the United States of America. There are many symbologies contained with it. The eagle, symbolic of our national bird, but also symbolic of God's protection, as an eagle who flutters over her nest. In one claw clutching 13 arrows, and in the other, an olive branch with 13 leaves. These are supposed to represent war and peace, but is that all they mean? No, not by a long shot. These two symbols are the exact symbols of the 13th tribe of Manasseh. The arrows and the olive branches. 13 stripes on the flag on the shield. And on the obverse, a pyramid with 13 steps, symbolizing where this people had once been in bondage. And the misting capstone, just as the Great Pyramid of Giza. Some say these are Masonic or occult symbols, and to some perhaps they are, but to others, we see the incomplete pyramid awaiting the chief cornerstone. The chief cornerstone which the builders rejected. In other words, awaiting the return of our Lord and Savior. The outline, missing the capstone, which has the all-seeing eye inside, some say symbolic of enlightenment. Others say symbolic of Satan replacing the chief capstone, which would go along with biblical prophecy that Satan shall come disguised as an angel of light or as the Antichrist. 13 letters, Anuit Coptis, meaning a people united. Motto, Novus Order Seclorum, a new order dawns, or a new order begins. 13 letters, E Pluribus Unum, out of many, one. And over the eagle, 13 stars in the shape of the Star of David, relating to Israel and our heritage. Some claim that these symbologies were derived under some vast Jewish conspiracy. Yet, if there is a conspiracy, it has less to do with the Jews of the tribe of Judah and more to do with those who call themselves Jews, as written in the book of Revelation chapter 2 and 3. In other words, the seed line of Cain. Again, a study for another time. And speaking of stars, all of our military vehicles, from jeeps to motorcycles to tanks to planes, have always borne stars, as do many of our medals and rank insignias of our servicemen. Has God not fulfilled His promise to Abraham? Has He not multiplied the children of Israel as the stars of heaven and the sands of the seashore? As He promised He would, Abraham? Has the seed not been called an Isaac? so that they have been a blessing to the entire world? Have they not liberated nations? Have they not stalemated communism? Has not the gospel been published amongst all nations through the seed of his children of promise as foretold by our Father? Have not many come from other peoples and races to the faith of Christ and been grafted on to the family tree of Israel? Finally, let us read from Romans chapter 9, the words of Paul. Romans chapter 9 and verse 6, and it reads, "Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all of Israel which are of Israel, neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall the seed be called." Verse 8, "That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of promise are counted for the seed." Again, Israel is the prince that prevails with God, and without God, he shall not prevail. If you've enjoyed this presentation, you can go and study yourself and learn a great deal more by looking into the books and chronicles of history and by study under great authors such as Dr. E. Raymond Capps, Dr. Barry Fell, Dr. J. H. Allen, and study of the Bible with Pastor Arnold Murray of the Shepherd's Chapel, located on the internet at www.shepherdschapel.com and also found here on YouTube on other YouTube channels. It is my prayer for you that you will dig into our Father's Word and dig back into history and look into these things to prove or disprove them. It is up to you to decide. May God light your way and reveal the truth to you, to the glorification of God.